I suppose the first step is to just take a super high level look at the page and see what top level containers we have. So I understand this app pretty well, but just from the outset, you can see that there's a couple of different panels, if you want to call them that here. We've got this left primary nav, we've got a little submenu thingy, and we've got this rest of what we call just the main content of the page. You'll notice there's a little bit of fanciness here about giving people more screen real estate. But for now, let's just treat that as a single panel. So that's sort of where I would start. So we've got some sort of high level layout, and we try to box things out, draw boxes around them. So let's try and translate that into our understanding of how we would implement that in Tailwind. So let me just quickly spin up the server. Forgot to have that running. Cool. So whenever we think about boxing things out with Tailwind, we think of having a top-level container that will then decide the layout for us, right? So here, we're going to be using, quick spoiler, we're going to be using Flex for this layout. So if I just spin together a Flex container, and we know that it's going to have three children, because we've just sort of conceptually boxed those out from just looking at the page at a super high level. So let's put those together. And we've got three of those. So let's call that primary nav, and this is submenu. And this was the main content. We can get rid of hello world. Cool. So that's just four divs, one parent, and three children. And if we go to our web page, you'll see that that hasn't done anything interesting for us. So that's actually just stuck all the words beside each other. It's roughly in the right order, which is cool. But one thing I suppose to call out first is that Flex has this concept of directions. So there's different ways in which Flex will allow you to lay out the content. So if I change, so the default is Flex row. The Tailwind docs are actually quite good for this. Flex direction. So there's a couple of different options here, row, call, and then the reverses of those, which we'll get to in a bit. So the default is row, but I'll show you what happens if we set this to call. So then that'll stack them on top of each other. So that's sort of more of a normal like block level layout, right? If I had put divs on top of each other, I would expect them to just sort of stack. If I get rid of Flex entirely, that's what it would do. But the default is actually what we care about here. So we can set this to row. And then what we could do is, just to make this a little bit easier, we can give these a bit of color. So we can sort of green 200, just so we can sort of more easily identify these while I'm talking about them. Cool. Let's see here. So now you'll see what has happened there is that we've colored just the size of the div that is needed to contain these items. So let's just give these a bit of artificial width, because we know we're going to have to fill some content into it in a second, but we can sort of mimic that for now by just giving them some fixed widths. These are sort of arbitrary numbers at the moment, but we can hone in on what those exact pixel values should be later, and then the main content. Cool. And now this last thing, so you notice we've given these first two, we've given them fixed widths, because that's kind of what our application structure looks like. But this last thing, we don't actually care about the exact pixel value of what the width of that is. We're happy for that to just fill up the rest of the space. So that arbitrary concept Flex allows us to implement by setting one of the Flex properties, which is called Flex Grow. If we go again, Tailwind docs are quite nice for this. If we go to the Flex docs, you'll see that Tailwind has utilities to sort of abstract some of this away to make this easier for us to apply quickly to templates. So Flex, when you apply Flex to an element, it sets three different properties: a grow, a shrink, and a basis. We won't get into the technical exact descriptions of what these are, but for now we'll use them to be useful to implement this UI. So here we're happy to just set Flex auto, and then that'll tell it to expand to fill up the rest of that direction that we have. So any of the rest of the content, it'll fill up that direction. Okay, so that's cool. So that's we've got this very roughly laid out. These things aren't tall enough, so let's make this container a little bit taller. Make it the height of the screen. Again, Tailwind has utilities for that. Don't need to go to the docs just now, but so that's, you know, roughly the super high level structure. So when we looked at this layout, we stepped back and said, okay, what are the top level boxes? And now we've put those boxes in the page. We give them nice colors. So that's cool. So where would we go from here? I suppose one thing to touch on super quick is that, so there's a concept in Flex of being a Flex container and being a Flex child. So these properties that I'm showing you here, the Flex one, the auto, the initial, all of these that set the grow and the shrink, those apply to children. So if I were to say, get rid of this Flex container, if I were to move this parent out such that it's no longer like a Flex layout context, these classes do nothing. It means nothing for these elements to have that. So let's see. If we head back to here, we can see here that this is roughly the right sort of content. Not exactly intercoms inbox just yet, but we're getting there. So I suppose that's like the first step, just to block out the content, and then you can progressively go down to closer and closer layers of detail to flesh out what exactly the app is supposed to look like. So I suppose the easiest thing to do here is just go left to right. So let's just mock out a few sort of placeholder content. Let's mock out some skeleton content for what these left nav items would look like. And so we can do that here in our primary nav sort of div. So let's see. Let's make these links. And we'll mock this up as just simple circles for now. Give these a color. And let's see, some arbitrary width. Yeah, they'll probably want a height as well. Cool, so what I'm doing here is just super quickly marking out the shape of these. Let's get rid of that red so we can actually see what we're doing. And marking out just a few little circles so that we can pretend that those are the icons that we've handcrafted. Cool. So let's see here. Cool. So this is, I suppose, another good example of where we aren't going in the default direction. So here we've got a bunch of links here, a bunch of items, and they're actually going in the vertical direction, right? So this flex column direction. So let's mock out a few more of these. And by default, those should all get their own, forgive me. By default, these will, here we are. These won't stack how we'd like to. Right, so we've made these divs, which is handy. But in order to achieve this layout of where we've got sort of a grouping up at the top and then another grouping at the bottom, we can use Flex's alignment and justification utility. So again, Tailwind Docs explains this sort of for us. So there's this concept of being on the main axis. When I mentioned that Flex has a direction, Flex is this concept of being on the main axis. So when you're moving along that direction, the justify properties are what's getting used. So if we were to say, set justify end to this container, so if I make that justify end, we're going to actually need to make this a flex column. You'll see that it chucks all of our lovely little icons down to the bottom left here. So that's not exactly what we want. What we actually want to do is have two separate groupings of those. So we can do that. We can artificially wrap those. Let's do that. That's great. So now let me just collapse these down so it's a little bit easier to see. Cool. So we still set justify end here, so it's chucking them down to the bottom. But if we look at the docs here, we can see there's a couple of different interesting ones. So there's space between, there's space around. And what we can actually use here is space between. So what space between will do is that all of my children equally apportion space such that it divides them apart from each other. So we'll see if I set this to between. What it's going to do is, because we've only got two, it's going to put one at the top and one at the bottom. And all of that space between is going to be allocated to the middle. So we've got that. That's lovely now sitting in the middle. We can give these, let's see. We can also then, one other useful set of utilities that we have is the alignment. So we've got align items. There's a couple of different align self items content here. Let's just go with the most useful one for us right now, because these are the properties that we can apply on the parent that will change the layout of all of the children. So here, what items does for us is it aligns, would you believe, the children on that off axis. So it instead, so if we're going in this vertical direction, the justify was applying to where those got spaced vertically, and the alignment will decide where they get placed horizontally. So on that off axis. Again, if we were, yeah, let's not do the horizontal. What do you call it? Explanation, because that'll just get too confusing. So let's say that we can go with item center here, and we'll see what that'll do to our content. Cool. So here, what it's done is that it's moved these lovely little icons into the very center there. So that's great. And one other thing we can do is Flex has got some handy utilities for space between. So that these are essentially classes that save us the time of having to sit down and manually put margin bottom or top on all of these items such that we have equal spacing between them, some fixed spacing. So if I set space and then a direction that I care about, so in this example it's Y, and then 2 or something, we'll see that it's gonna, it hasn't done it. Cool. Here we go. Let's make that a column. There we go. Cool. So now it's applied equal spacing between all of these. And you notice that I was able to set that on the parent, so on this top group, and I didn't have to apply it to each one of these children. Right. So you can change this content arbitrarily. And if at some stage you decided, cool, this needs to be, you know, this needs to be a little bit bigger of a gap, we can do that easily. Cool. So let's do that super easy. Let's make this. Let's actually make this. Give this a bit of padding just to give us a bit of space at the top. Cool. And then we can apply the same sort of spacing to the bottom group. So this is sort of the rough idea, right, of blocking out the content. Let's give ourselves a few more lovely circles up at the top here. Blocking out the content such that we get a feel for the top level layout of the page, right, because you don't need to be going into detail on the exact copy, the exact pixel of the very precise icon at this level, right? You can sort of zoom in and get more sort of granular detail as you go along. So that's kind of us. We've got this left now. We're happy with that. Let's give it a bit of a color, because it's got a bit of a darker color than just the white background. So this container here, we can give that. Let's give that a bit of color and see what that does. Cool. So it's a little bit hard to see when it's beside the screen. So let's get rid of that green for now too. And now that's sort of off gray. Tailwind's default colors have a bit of a blue hue to them. Of course, you can customize that to be whatever you like to fit your palette. We've of course got it customized to our internal design systems palettes. So cool. So that's at the top level. Any questions just after that?
No, I guess there's some things, some subtlety that we can come back to in the future, mm-hmm. like the little red circle that's kind of positioned relatively.
Yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, no, that makes perfect sense, and that's a solid start.
Cool. Great stuff. Cool, so let's give this a bit of a color, as well, just to start off, because it has that. Let's see, because it's not just white this year. You notice it beside the main content, which is actually white. Cool, and then the submenu, nothing super complicated in here either. So again, a lot of the power of Flex is just being able to say, to break this up into different squares or rectangles on the page and say, okay, I know that there are things either beside each other or on top. If you were to try and sit down and, you know, draw boxes around these, you want to draw them such that, you know, there's no sort of overlapping lines. Like say here, I would never have inbox and conversations here in the same div. Because I need the search icon to be beside inbox. So those sort of things about like slicing this up in ways that you can lay out the different small little UI elements using the Flex primitives, right? So what do I mean by that? So here, if I just show you that simply, here, make a little Flex container, and I put a little H1 in here. And that says inbox, and then this other icon. One thing you showed me the other day was this concept of hero icons, which absolutely fascinating. Super quick. Let's to pull in a search icon. That's an inbox. Cool. Let's pull in a search icon. Make this a bit smaller. Cool. We get rid of so many there. So at the super top level, so these the default flex direction is again row, which is what we want, right? We want this search icon to be beside the inbox text, not beneath it or above it. So that's cool. Let's make this inbox text actually a little bit bigger. So Tailwind has some utilities around setting CSS properties that pertain to font. Font like weight. Let's pick one of those. I believe they also have plugins for setting typographic scales and all this fancy stuff. But for now, let's just mock this out with setting raw properties. Text size. Let's see here. Let's pull one of these in. Cool. And so we're just super rough. Like, this doesn't need to be pixel perfect just yet. We're just getting a feel for the sort of the size of these items. Cool. And so this is a nice sort of example of there's a couple of different things we want to change here. So we're in this like super small part of the UI. This, like, we've zoomed fully into to the two simplest things that we can look at here. And there's something a little bit off, right? So for one, the search icon's right beside the inbox. We'd like it to be chucked over to the right somewhere to give it a little bit more space, bring it closer to the main content. And it's also misaligned, right? So it's sitting up to the top of this. It's beside this sort of tall line height element. So there's a couple of different things we need to fix here, and Flex will let us do that pretty simply. So cool. So this Flex container, this parent, let me just make this red to show you what exactly we're playing with here. So this is the Flex container that we care about changing. And so again, this justify between becomes super helpful. Justify between here, that's going to equally apportion the space between the two children. Like, say, for example, if I pull in another icon here, it's going to put space between them equally. But it's quite simple often if you've only got a couple of items to just set justify between. One alternative way you could do this is in saying that is to use those flex properties that we talked about before, which is the grow and the shrink. So if I don't want to set, say, justify between here, what I can do is I can say that can still just be a flex container. It's oftentimes nice to just be explicit about setting row just so you can see exactly what those get applied to. So if I were to set this to auto here, that would sort of achieve the same sort of layout for us, right? So behind the scenes, it's not actually apportioning space between these items at the, like, the flexbox level. What it's doing is allowing this H1 to actually just be that full width, right? So if you see here, it is way larger than its content needs it to be, but that's fine too, because, you know, you could see this this dynamic content changing. Let's give ourselves a little bit of padding here. Let's have a little bit just so we have a bit of breathing room around the edges. Cool. Cool. So that's one way of doing it. But one thing you need to be careful of when setting those is that if your content in these growing containers gets too large, it's going to start abusing the other content in the page, right? So we told this icon to be a certain size, but it does not care. Flex has decided that it can afford to steal away a few pixels from this. So one way to avoid that is to, again, Flex has some useful utilities for this. When Flex utilities, we can set Flex none, which I believe what this translates to is 0, 0 auto. So that's the portion of that we care about is that this second property, the shrink property, is set to 0, which means I cannot shrink. Please don't shrink me. Don't steal my pixels. So we can set that on the icon, flex none, and now that's going to let that be the right size. So it's like, okay, this thing is going to start wrapping. It's going to start overflowing. Whatever. So that's cool, right? So those are the two different options where you can have one of the pieces of content that you're happy to take up all of the rest of the space. You can either have it grow, or at the parent level, you can say justify between.
If we use justify between, would we would that shrinkage happen of the icon?
Yeah, it would. It? Yeah, no, exactly. It would still happen. So the same shrink, if we haven't specified on the child what exactly, if it's allowed to shrink, the default is for it to be allowed to. So yeah, we would still need to set flex none. So it's actually a little bit cleaner, I think, for us to just to not have that grow and just set this to justify between. And we'll see here. That should have the exact same effect. Cool. I deleted more than I wanted to there. Cool. So that's one of our problems gone, right? So that sort of main access problem of the justification. Cool. We've chucked that search icon way over to the right there. That's great. But now the alignment is off, right? Because this is still a pretty tall line height item. So let's fix that again with the align properties. Align center. So that looks lovely. But again, it doesn't. What have I done? What have I done here? Items, sorry. It's not align center, it's items. Item center, there we go. All right, of course, because there's a couple of different alignment properties. If I go back to here, self, items, and content. So again, the Tailwind docs does a pretty good example of this. Self is basically just if I want to be able to set the alignment on a child-by-child basis. So here you can see that 2 has decided to be up at the top. And there's, let's see, what's the other one called? It's so seldom that we use these that I don't think I've actually ever written this Tailwind class definition for the content. But basically, this describes what happens to the block as a whole. So if you can see here, all right, exactly that. Yeah, so it's not being applied to the children themselves, but to that entire container. But yeah, for our intents and purposes, you can get 90% of the way there, more than 90% of the way there, by just using justify content and align items. So that is what we're going to do. And again, that shows sort of the power of just being able to mock these things out super quickly using a handful of properties. Cool, so we can get rid of this red here because we're happy with how that looks now. And so that's one container up at the top. Let's give ourselves another class. If I could spell that, that'd be great. So again, we don't need to go into a bunch of detail here. It's not super interesting to flesh out a bunch of this stuff. A lot of the patterns that I've just explained up here will apply to this as well, right? You can see a bit of content to the left being spaced between some content to the right. So yeah, trust me, let's just put some squares in the page. You know, trust me that we know how to build this, and then we can move on to more interesting parts of the design. We can back to them if we need to, if we have time. BG red, and let's give this a height, some fixed height. We don't necessarily care what that looks like. It's just some divs in the page.
BG red 200.
That's a good idea. Yeah, we have customized this palette internally, so we don't necessarily use the default one, so I keep forgetting. Cool, so those are stacked together. Let's change that such that we give these a little bit of breathing room. Flex call again. So we're looking at this entire sort of off-white container. And what we can do again is just set these space between utilities. So space Y, let's give that 4 or something, right? And that'll put even spacing between them. So that's lovely. One thing that you might notice is that there's more space between the inbox and this first sort of group of submenu sections than between the submenu sections themselves. So you can do that using regular old margin utilities. So this top level that we've sort of isolated from the rest of it, you could just say, let's just pick an extreme example to show, margin bottom 16, right? So you can use those in conjunction with the space Y. Again, margins will collapse where they need to, but you can just specify one that's a little bit bigger than you need it to be. So let's say 6 here. It gives it a little bit more breathing room, and not the entire margin, but just margin bottom. Cool. So that's sort of roughly in the right direction. So you'll trust me that we know how to make those squares look correct, and we can move on to the main content. So cool. Let's do that. So let's get rid of this garish blue, and let's see. We'll make this background white. You'll notice, I'm typing utility classes here to achieve a design that we haven't actually fully looked at yet. So you notice that we've got sort of a rounded bit of a container, and it's got a bit of a border, and it's actually got a bit of a drop shadow here as well, or sorry, a box shadow. So let's do that. So rounded in content. Would you believe I'm just using arbitrary nouns here and applying them to the div, and it's working. But no, yeah, Tailwind's got some pretty good default naming for these things. But yeah, so what those utilities are doing, it's allowing us rounded corners. It's allowing us to specify these utilities, right? So before, without Tailwind, you would have had to have created a class for this, dip out to CSS, switch from the template out to another file, and specify this on some class. So, you know, our existing app might have like main content. And then you would apply like rounded and shadow and stuff to that. But what we can do is we can compose a bunch of different utilities to achieve that. So what we've currently got is actually not super correct. So actually, why Why has that not rounded anything for us? BG wide flex auto. Mean content. Is it actually rounded? Oh, it is. It is. It's just tiny. Let's make that much bigger. Forget the t-shirt sizing scale it uses. Is that it? Yeah, cool, cool, cool. So that's it. And let's give that a border so it's a little bit easier to see. Border red. And we should probably have a border before we tell it that it's red. Of course, red isn't a thing that exists in this palette. So let's go red 200. Cool. So we can see now, let's make that a little bit darker, actually. Contrast is important. Cool. So we can see what's happened there is that we've got a border and we've got a border radius at the corner, which is great. But we're rounding every single one of these corners. So the default rounded class will apply to just the entire element. But there are some modifiers in those classes that allow us to just do to the corners that we care about. So let's see. Do any one of these examples have exactly what we want? Look at this, rounded TL. So instead of rounded XL, we can go rounded TL and then XL. So that's the direction or the side and then the size. So cool. Now if we go back to here, we can see, cool. So it's just this one that we care about.
Beta, you're probably too young to remember this, but have you ever like achieved rounded corners by opening up Photoshop and doing the rounded corners and cutting them up?
I have not.
That's how we used to do it in the day. You'd create a table and you'd have the top left and the top right, and you'd do it. It was a nightmare.
This is you'd rasterize out a little.
Yeah. That's the way we used to do it.
Boy, oh boy! No, thankfully that was before my time. Now we can just set a single class and it'll do it for us. Yes, this is cool. One thing that this, I don't actually know if you'll see here, but let's make this a little bit easier to see by making this dark. Pardon me, darker. We're actually bleeding through. So so this sort of visual design here, what it has us to believe is that this main content is actually sitting atop of this like submenu section. And you can see on the actual app here that this like seamlessly is the same color, it transitions in through. So this is actually, if I go back to our app here, simply incorrect, right? So this is not bleeding through at all. So that's the sort of, you know, pixel perfect stuff that that we can come back to in the end. But because we actually have a fix for it right now, let's just do that. So the way that we get around this in our app is that to say that the entire page actually has a given background. So you might apply this to the body or whatever. 200, let's just exemplify that by making that red 800. So you see here that now this is applying to just this section that's behind this this border radius. Cool, so let's do that. Let's set that to whatever it is. Oops, not Ray. It's like 100, so whatever the submenu section was. And where was our submenu here? It's hiding down here. Cool. Cool. So like we're most of the structure there to like we've sort of like it's this sort of mode of thinking of like I don't actually care what the copy says, what the exact text is, but if I'm blocking out the high level things about the page, you can tackle the layout separate from the content, right? So you can apportion the section such that you've got the like you could argue we're maybe 20% of the way there to the full layout of the page, and we've only applied we've got, oops, I'm recording a macro. That's simply not what I wanted. One second. We've got like 18 divs. Cool. So 18 divs has gotten us to most of the way of the page. So it's just sort of this incremental box things out and you can flesh out the pixel perfect detail later. So let's get rid of this garish border. Let's make that some other color. Actually, the default border should probably be fine. And we actually don't want to border the whole way around this thing. We actually only care about the left. Actually, that's not fully true. There's a bit of a cheat. You'll see that there's it sort of tapers as it goes up to the top. How we actually achieve this in the app is that we've got a single pixel box shadow, but we don't need to get into that exact just yet. So just trust me that we can achieve this wherever we like to. But this shadow is actually not super close to what we have in the app. So let's see here. What do we have? Shadow inner. Cool, these docs are cool. So we've got a couple of different options here. Let's go for XL. That seems close enough. Shadow XL. And again, so this is just a utility for not having to run around and type out all of this. So I'm creating a new custom class for this and then applying these arbitrary pixel values that I'm sure look great and a highly principled designer has handpicked. We can just drop those on. And of course, you can configure this to whatever your app, whatever your app's needs are. If you've got some proprietary border shadow technology, feel free to set that either. Cool. So we've still got our main content. And that's looking close, right? So we're getting there. So let's see. Cool. So I suppose that's another. So that's sort of a milestone. We can step back and say, cool. So at the high level, we've blocked out a good chunk of the app. So we've fleshed out some placeholder content for the navigation and the submenu, and now we're into another sort of zoom level. So now we've got a separate pane on the app that we can take this sort of top level, okay, what are the main boxes approach to laying this out. So if we go again and look, if you wanted to, you could be cheeky and like just get rid of that entire menu, right? So all we care about is what's in this section here. I'm not going to do that because the zoom's awkward to scroll through, but so looking at this main content, we see it's got a sort of a similar layout to the previous one. It's still in this sort of row direction. We've got these sort of panels that are beside each other, so we can pretty easily mock that out too. Let's do that. Let's bring back our trusty RGB divs.
I'm just going to bring my puppy out to the back for a few minutes. I'll be back.
Excellent. No worries. Cool. And we are, let's see what we're rendering now. We're rendering nothing because these divs don't actually have any content. So that's not interesting at all. So let's say left, center, right. And now you'll see, okay, good example. These are on top of each other, right? Because we're not in a flex container. So these, again, these flex properties, we set this flex auto. We set this flex auto on this sort of main content div container. That's a flex child property. So that defines how it's going to be laid out with respect to its parent. That doesn't turn this div itself into a flex container. That setting that property does not in any way change how this element's children are going to be laid out. So if we want to make this a flex container, we have to also say flex, right? So you set this flex utility class. And again, this isn't magic. This is, if we just go to display, it's the exact same as block or inline, right? If this was a span, you would have inline. You could turn it into a table if you wanted to, right? So setting flex literally just sets display flex, that property, and then you can use a bunch of the other utilities to augment how that will actually get laid out. So I've got a big side menu stuff here, but you'll see, yeah. So flex, wrap, direction, grow, shrink, all of this utility stuff, even order. We don't use that all that often, but yeah, this stuff all exists. So flex isn't magic, it's just setting display flex. And if I were to do that and set that, so the default is row, so what it's going to do is it's going to make this nice for us again and chuck those beside each other. So let's be just a little bit explicit and say row there. Cool. So these aren't filling up the full space. We could do that if we wanted to, again, to exactly mimic our previous layout. We could make that flex auto to make that grow out to the right. It's not doing that. Why isn't it doing that? Flex row, because I haven't set flex row and I haven't set flex auto on that guy. Cool. Missing space. Cool. So now that's chucked that right box out to the far right. Let's take a look at the app. How do we want to split this up? If I recall correctly, so there's some responsive breakpoints and stuff in the app. We don't need to fully get into, you know, how that works or what those exact pixel values or percentage values are. Let's just say that this is roughly a fifth on the right and then 3/5 in the middle. Some arbitrary approximation. We can hone in on what exactly that is later. How do you type that? 1/5? We don't use these super often, but we can use them here. So let's do that, and then this doesn't need to be flex auto anymore. Does that work? Cool. So that works. And again, one thing to notice is that we set the border radius on the parent. So if we actually needed this left red thing to have a background, we'd need to set a border radius on it as well, or to set, you know, overflow hidden on the parent. Yada yada yada. We don't need to get into it. But You'll notice this deja vu. We're sort of in the same place that we were at the very start of, like, we've blocked out this content. We've given it some lovely, lovely colors, and now we can flesh that out with some more interesting, content. So let's, at a super high level, let's pass through that. So let's, this is not red. These colors we do not care about at all. There's actually color on this rightmost boil. So that's gray, same sort of gray as this, I think. Don't know what number we picked for that. Bow gray, yeah. So let's set that to gray. Yeah, close enough. Cool. And now the center as well, we can set. It's got a bit of a border left and right. Can you go LR? I don't crawl.
I think so.
Let's hope so. You don't think so? Okay. Let's split those out.
Well, I'll try it. I mean.
let's find out. There's only one way to know. Yep, you're right. Doesn't work. Cool. So let's border L and border R to split those out. That's far too heavy. Let's make that a little bit smaller. Still feels a bit too heavy. Yeah, don't need to be pixel perfect here. It's a matter of changing a single value later. I've skipped one and jumped right out of where I want to be. Cool. So that's close enough, right? So we've demarcated these separate sections. I've got the left, the center, and the right. So let's flesh through this. So there's a little bit of more interesting stuff to look at here in terms of flex layout, because we've got overflow and stuff. So let's get into that. Cool. Let's do that. Let's see. So we can leave those two as they are. Let's give us a little bit of breathing room between these. Let's change this left to be to have some content, right? So when we look at this, it's sort of more interesting, right? Because as we've already mentioned, there's overflow happening. We'll notice there's sort of this like static fixed header up at the top. You could think of that as being sticky. It's not really. It's just sort of fixed, and then this section scrolls. As you can see by where the scroll bar is actually placed here, it's only in this container. So let's do that. We can mock up a div and a div below it, and this one is allowed to scroll. So let's mock that out. We'll probably want to give this a class later. I should really set up my editor to automate this better. My expansions are not what they used to be. Let's see, cool. So what has that done for us? Absolutely nothing. Excellent, because there's no content in there. So this is top, scrolling bottom. And that has placed them on top of each other, again, because this is just a regular layout mode. If we had set this to flex, it would chuck those beside each other, which is cool. It's not actually what we want, though. But what we can do is set this back to the call direction. And then don't necessarily actually need to use flex here. And as an example, let's just not use it. So flex isn't actually... we don't actually need to. So let's do this here. So let's set this to some fixed height. What should this be? 16, we'll give it a color. Again, just to show what the content is. Top, width, actually no, that's not what I wanted. We're going in this direction. The height, so cool, that's some height. Should actually probably be a bit bigger. We have 24, I forget which values we have. Again, we've customized these numbers. Cool, so yeah, top, and then the scrolling bottom. So let's make some content here, some arbitrary content just for now, just to show exactly what this scrolling container will look like. So class, what do we want this to be? We'll give it some fixed height. Again, these won't be blue yet, but just to show. I can't spell, but you'll trust me that that's going to be okay. And so this is the container that we want to scroll. So we'll probably have, instead of me pasting a bunch of times, let's, how do I do this? Range 100. Probably want to open a block as well. This is just a little bit of Ember templating language. We don't need to get into the specifics of what that does for us. It's not Tailwind specific, but just know that it's going to spit out a bunch of containers for us here. A tags must have, yes, yeah, indeed, they must. Cool, so we've got a bunch of stuff here, and we've very, very successfully destroyed our layout. So what's happening here is that we haven't actually specified what we want this container to do whenever it doesn't have enough space to contain our content. Tailwind has some nice utilities for that. Would you believe? they've sat down and thought about this stuff. Cool. So we've got, we can set based on the direction. We can set any one of these overflow properties. So let's go for overflow Y auto. Again, X and Y, those two directions. Overflow Y auto. And now that has not worked. Cool. So let's actually make this a flex container. So the trick here is that we've told it to overflow Y auto, but this full like left section parent hasn't actually set a fixed height on this thing at all. I suppose we could mimic that by setting this to like H screen perhaps. Will that do what we want? No, it won't. Okay, cool. So let's forego that and let's fall back to the safe happy known of using flex to apportion these. Call, please. Cool. So flex call. And again, because we already know that there's some content beneath it that's going to want to grow to be as big as it can, right? There's a dynamic contents popping in. These can grow arbitrarily large. We're going to set flex none on this top container to say don't steal any content from this. And then this can be flex auto again. So just say the top thing is some fixed height, but the rest of this just fill up to whatever space you can. So here we are. Okay, cool. Right, we're back into safe territory here. We haven't destroyed our layout. This is now scrolling for us. You'll notice that these are actually beside each other. It's because I made these A tags. That's fine. If you wanted to, you can make those block. And again, that's just your way of setting this. That's a good example. Let's put that back. And let's see what's happened here. Our submenu has been absolutely destroyed. And that's because at the very top level, we hadn't actually encountered this necessity for flex none yet, right? So let's just set that. So beside these widths, so they remember, flex none. So say, do not steal pixels from me. Go away, please. Thank you. So where did we have our widths here? Yeah, flex none. And now we'll notice that this will expand out. Cool. So we've told it these are fixed static content on the left. Don't steal any pixels from them. Please flex. Cool. So now let's make these back into blocks again. Again, we're not being super accurate here on like the semantic structure of the page. It's as close as it needs to be for us to lay out this content. Of course, we can tweak this structure afterwards. So cool. So that's the top level. We've got these things scrolling, so that's great. Like these conversation cards, they're looking pretty ugly right now, but let's make those not blue. Let's give those a border. Border bottom. Yeah, cool. Why not? Cool. So those are close enough. Let's give it some padding. And again, you can tweak these values as much as you need to. Just get a little bit closer to this design. I suppose one little bit of flourish here that we have is this this concept of like this this little selected state. So this is, I suppose, one sort of interesting thing to discuss is your ability to use Tailwind in conjunction with like a component library or a way of abstracting some reusable parts of your template out into components. Here you can imagine that this, like you could insert instead of us. So once we get this perfect and we've fleshed out all of the exact layout and the template for this like link to a conversation, you could pull that out in one component and encapsulate all of the like the layout or the render specific logic that's only related to this card, right? So like a selected state, a hover state, setting the colors, all of those. You could actually, the hover state is not a good example because we can set that with just pure CSS, but like the selected state, for example, to set this border where we can conditionally set those. You could pull that out into its own component, encapsulate that, and have that burrowed away such that you can just invoke one of those instead of having to have that live at the top level. But we don't need to get into that now. Let's just super quickly show that we can achieve this this little tiny little piece of UI flourish of setting the border L some size 200 something more saturated. Let's see. Cool. And that doesn't care about that at all because there's no actual content inside it. Cool. This typo is going to live forever if I don't fix it. And conversation card. Cool. And now, yeah, cool. So that makes sense. We've told it to put this lovely border on the left, but we actually applied the padding to the parent. So let's move that down. Cool. Now we're getting closer. And this doesn't actually need to be H16 anymore. We can actually flesh out the content of this, right? So let's see what we have. What structure do we have? So again, the same sort of design of like, if you zoom into just this level, so just this blue background thing, how would you draw the boxes such that you can actually put the content in there? So again, you would never really have this Nikola Tesla and the avatar be in the same container as this like long form content, right? Because there's no way that those two could be there if the icon wasn't also. And that's sort of in a different flow direction, right? So you couldn't have these stacked on top of each other and then somehow have this this like timestamp or the little tick anywhere else in the flow. So you have to sort of box these out such that those are so that those make sense in terms of like the super simple primitives of just like things are either on top of or beside each other, and we can space them wherever we want to, but there's no getting around the fact that these two have to be in the same div. Of course you could get into fancy stuff of relative and absolute positioning and like pixel perfect choosing exactly where these things are going to go, but for the simplest flows and for the most sort of maintainable flows, just use the layout primitives. So let's do that. Let's super quickly mark those out again. You'll be sick of seeing these colors by the end of it, but just as an example of what I'm talking about, top and bottom. Cool. So the red and the green, here's what I'm talking about. So this, the red is going to be the Nikola Tesla and the click, and the bottom is going to be this sort of snippet preview of what's in the conversation. Cool. So let's get rid of conversation card. Turns out that typo wouldn't have lived long at all. And now we can think of these things sort of separately, right? So we don't actually care what's in this bottom one yet, but we can think of this one now that we've zoomed in and we know that this red part is the thing that we're designing here. Let's see what this is actually supposed to look like. Right, so we've got some content on the left and some content on the right. So before we even decide what that content is, we can already sort of tell what we're going to lay this out to. So it's going to be flex row and justify between. And we could even be so bold as to go one more step and say, we know that we're going to want these all to be on the same sort of line. Like we're going to want these all to be in the same line in that direction. So that involves aligning them across the cross direction to be centered. So let's item center. Right. So before we've even put any content on our page, we know that, let's just say, so that doesn't go away. Bottom, close enough. Bottom. Let's say that we have a little span here, A, and then B.
The class at the bottom, Dave, is a little messed up.
Ah, it is. How did I do that? Excellent. Cool. Thanks for that. So let's see, A, B. So before we'd even decided what this content needed to be, we could take a look at the design and say, cool, so we know these things need to be laid out in a certain way, so it doesn't exactly matter what the final content's going to be, but we can set that. We can set the layout ahead of time. So let's flesh that out. So let's say that this is a little circle. Do we have an avatar icon, perhaps, in hero icons? Person. No, we don't appear to. Let's pick some arbitrary. Let's say that everyone wears a hat. Cool, so we can put that. We can put that here. These shouldn't be spans. Again, so when we're inside of Flexlet, like the semantic meaning of a span versus a div, like span doesn't give us anything. The display mode is going to be changed. Like the parent is deciding how we're going to be laid out, so it might as well just be a div for these static content, especially like images like we have here. So let's do this also. And let's set this. This is a container. So let's say Nikola Tesla, cool. Let me turn on wrapping so that we don't need to look at that full SVG content. And let's make this a bit small. So let's see what's happened here. How close are we now? Cool. So those are on top of each other. So let's fix that. That's cool. So again, at the top level, we had sort of laid this out as one item. But let's see. I suppose this might be another example of where we, the question of justification versus the letting one of the children grow could be had, of like, if we allow this sort of name section to grow, then we don't need to worry about this being a container and this being a separate container and then this having its own sort of layout. So let's do that. Let's simplify this down to this just being, if you see what I'm deleting here, just this div being gotten rid of. And now this here can flex grow. So that middle bit, the name can flex grow, and now we can get rid of the justification, because now the test, the middle part, is going to fill up the full space. Cool, so we're close enough there. Let's see. Icon is absolutely too small. And again, this is just a placeholder. It'll be dynamic content coming from the user profile, but we can very easily mark that together. And again, if we wanted to, you could just set like margin right of something here on this icon to give a little bit of breathing room to on that. We could also just set our space utilities, right? So here in this container, space x of 2 or something. All right, and that'll put space between these all. Cool. So that's sort of close. This text is actually quite big. Flex grow. Can we make that smaller? Oops. I have caps lock on. Not a good idea. Can that get a little bit smaller? Cool. So that looks good. That icon. It's actually not as... not as visually similar as I had hoped, but you'll trust me that we could fill that with anything that we wanted to. Cool. And then this example of this, I suppose, is another nice example of like truncation happening. So let's do that too. So let's so in this bottom green container that we're working on now, we can again sort of see that this is moving in the horizontal direction, so the flex row direction. So let's do that. Doesn't need to be green anymore, which is great. And we can, let's see, pull in another icon. Let's pick this one. We'll make it a little bit smaller because it is a smaller sort of admin preview. So, and now we have some other content. So this can be a div or whatever. We don't actually care. And we're going to want it to grow, to fill whatever. So this is some message content. So let's see, is that, so that, you know, happily enough, that string is just small enough to not get truncated yet, but we'll get to that in a sec. Cool, so the same sort of stuff has happened here where the alignment is off because line heights are a thing. So this is actually really tiny. Can we make these a little bit bigger? Sorry, moving pixels around so that this example is a little bit better. But so the alignment thing we're talking about, items, center. Cool, so those are beside each other, and we can put a little bit of space between those. Space X, 2, love it. Might actually need to be a bit smaller. But again, so we're sort of shifting around pixels here. I suppose that's one thing I haven't really touched on, is like, where do these numbers come from? Like, one, what is that? What is that unit? So that, if we look at the Tailwind docs, a good example of this is, so the default is for it to be related to relative element unit. So that's based on the size of the body of your application or your page. We've actually internally got these mapped to direct pixel values so that they map our 4-pixel grid internally. So like PX1 is just 4 pixels for us, but the default config is totally fine. We can use it here. It's a close enough approximation. We don't need to go fiddling with our config right now. But just in case you're wondering where those values are coming from, that's it. And it's the same sort of units. So these padding and the, what else do we have here? Yeah, like the padding, the space between, and the margins, they're all using the same sort of unit system. So a 1 here means a 1 up there as well. So that's super handy to, you know, once you get into the flow of like understanding, you know, visually that, you know, let's say, this gap is either a 1 or a 2, then it becomes just sort of second nature to just sort of drop those in. And of course, you can tweak those if they're not exactly pixel perfect. Cool. So we've gotten to that. So let's make this some arbitrarily long content that's going to overflow. So that's not exactly what we'd wanted. Okay, so another example of our lovely little icon getting terribly abused here by this flex grow. So again, flex none, you are not allowed to make this smaller. That'll get bigger. Cool. And Tailwind also has truncation utilities. So if I literally just put the word truncate on it as if it's a command, it will, I can set truncate on this big, long, overflowing piece of content, and it'll truncate for me. So that's cool. The text is actually a bit too big, so let's see what Tailwind tells us about that. How small can we get text access? That seems useful. Cool. How are we looking now? Close enough, right? So that's super close. There's some spacing between these, so we can again do that at the top level. So this is the container that we care about. Space y of 2 or 4. It actually looks quite big. I'm not exactly sure. 16, close enough. All right, so if we zoom out, sorry, I've been zoomed in there, so it's sort of hard to see the perspective. But we're sort of close enough there. We're roughly on the right size. It might actually, from all my zooming in, be a bit too small still, but let's tweak that a little bit so we can make this a 3 or whatever. And again, so it's not exactly important that we get this design to match up perfectly. It's more the principles of getting to translate a picture, in the worst case just a JPEG of a design, and be able to translate that into boxes on the page such that you can have these things be interactive. Cool. And this B, that by default I think is some content. Let's see. Oh yeah, some timestamp. So B, let's set that to 5 hours. Excellent. And again, that could be a span or whatever, but it isn't super important for us here in this demo, just in this. But what is important is that it's actually the right size. So we can make that a bit smaller. And is it actually cool? Yeah, it is. Okay, this is another good example of being able to use the Tailwind utilities to configure color here. So this is sort of like it's a gray, it's sort of a de-emphasized text. So let's see. We can use text color, and this can pull in any of our palette values that exist. So let's do that. 200. Don't know what exactly is good here. Again, these will have been hand chosen to have contrast ratios that are distinctly better than this. So let's actually do that. Again, this doesn't need to be the exact shade of gray here, but we will we'll get close to it. 6. Maybe that's reasonable. Close enough. So yeah, for this demo, it's close enough. Cool. Let's actually give this a different icon. Circle. Oh, user circle. Oh, I was searching for person. Okay, cool. All right, so we find a perfect, in our spelunking, we find a perfect icon to set as a placeholder here. Again, on the left side, we actually just use this as a circle, but we'll be a little bit higher res here. So we'll set that to 5. Cool. And where was this other one down here? We had set this to set you to this. Cool. And now, how are we looking? Look at those. Those are users if I've ever seen them. Those are icons. Great. Cool. So those are scrolling. What we've done is we've set this border on all of them, so we can sort of mock out what that would look like using, say, conditionals. So say, as I some index. So we can arbitrarily pick the second one to get to the border. This border L border blue. Let's see here. If that's that, then you can get this lovely little bit of flourish to show that you're selected. Let's see. So now only one of them. Cool. That's one indexed. Excellent. So now this is getting that. And what it also gets is a bit of background color. So it actually gets to keep the BG blue 200.
Do we want to apply the border on all of them so that it isn't shifted in a couple of pixels?
Ah, great idea. Cool. So we can border L here. Cool. So what Gavin has just brought up here is that, so say if we were to only apply, okay, let's actually visualize that using the inspector. So it might be a little bit hard to notice here because it's only a couple of pixels, but all of this content is out of line with this item because we've set border L 2 on this, which means that all of the content inside this, so this container is actually 2 pixels smaller than the rest of all of these. So let me show you here. So if we get down into brass tacks and see what the actual size of, say, for example, like this container is, what's that being computed to? 223.8. And this boyo is different. Oh, it's 223.8. Okay, yeah, because we got box sizing, it's computing those as the same. But if we were to look at, say, for example, this content will be different. So this here, we've got 137.8. And in this one, it is 199, right? So here we've lost those 2 pixels because we've said that only the selected ones have this. So all of the content has to be a little bit smaller to compensate. But of course, we can fix that by just always applying it and having it only be visible if we actually want to see it. So let's do that. So border left 2 will always be a thing. I think by default, that'll actually give us a color on that border. It will. Cool. So we can knock that off by saying... probably set the color to transparent. Yeah, cool. So let's do that. So then the border color. Might be look a little bit strange, but this is basically just saying if this is the selected card, whatever abstraction we have around that, this is probably live in a component. We want it to have the border and a background. But if it's not that, then we can set the border to transparent. So let's show that. Cool. So now those are all perfectly in line. If I pull it over here and scroll over to the left, you see that those are all perfectly in line, which we didn't have before. Cool. So that's, you know, that's close. We've got selected states. We can conditionally apply these utility classes to get sort of more interesting interactions with the app. So that's cool. So let's see here. How are we getting on? So yeah, that's close. And we can also do hover states, right? So if you notice, I don't know if the contrast is good enough in the recording to show, but if I hover over these, the background is changing ever so slightly. So let's set that as well. So, and that doesn't matter. Oh, it does matter whether we're selected. We don't want to change the border when we're selected. So let's on hover. So these are sort of the prefix. Where are those documented? Oops. Hover. Oh, there's a good tutorial for you. So let's hover. Let's see.
Here, if you do like background, you'll get a hover pseudo class.
Background, not size. Goodness. Forgive me, I'm having trouble with Algolia. Pseudo class.
I think if you scroll down, it should be a hover there.
So there we go. Yeah, cool. So they've got demos of this. Of setting this sort of prefix to utility class allows it to be applied whenever you have interactions. There's also ones for focus and some other states. I think they've also got focus within on some of the newer builds, but hover is what we care about here, so let's use that. And so again, so we're sort of in this second leg of the conditional because we only want to actually change the hover state whenever we're not selected, right? We don't want to, if we had a blue background because it was selected, hovering over that, we don't want it to change to some light gray just because we're hovering over it, we're ready on that. So let's go, let's set this to some arbitrary number as well. Again, not pixel perfect, doesn't exactly have to match, but it's close enough. If I show you here, you'll see the difference between those two. Let's actually make that super visible. Let's go to our good friend Ready at 100 just to show that, just to make sure it comes through on the video again, right? So that's just applying the hover pseudo selector and we can super easily mock that up. So that's cool, right? So we've got the scrolling list of conversations. I won't spend any more time getting pixel perfect on this. We've sort of gone to the level of detail that I think is useful for this demonstration, but let's super quickly mock this out. Actually, is there anything interesting happening there? There isn't really, right? So do you think we should flesh this out instead of just moving on to some more interesting content over here? Or
yeah, I think it's better to do the more interesting stuff. If we have time at the end, we can come back.
Cool.
Otherwise, just leave it as a block. I think it's fine.
Cool. Cool, so let's do that. So we can actually knock out this part super easy. It's pretty actually simple. It's just a fully overflowing container. So let's do that. So again, this is our rightmost container. We've got some gray. We can already tell we're going to want it to overflow in this direction. So the difference between auto and scroll here is that if it doesn't actually have enough content to need to scroll, it won't give a scroll bar on certain browsers, which is nice. So that's cool. So we can set auto on that. We tend to default to that in our app, but it's mostly personal preference, I suppose. Cool. So we can overflow. We'll put some content in here. So let's see. don't actually care exactly what's in here. I'm not going to flesh out the content, because that's not the interesting part of this exercise. Cool. So let's make this a container as well. One thing to look at. So I'm sort of apportioning off one container for the top and then one big container for the bottom that contains all of these sort of inbox card style things. So let's do that. So this top container, it's got some fixed height. No, it doesn't actually. Let's stick with flex. Pardon me. Flex call. One second. Cool. So flex call, and we don't care about space between those just yet. Flex non border B, and what color is this? Probably. Again, so I'm being specific here about setting a border, just because we're on sort of already a gray background, so it needs to be sort of darker than normal to actually be visible. Otherwise, it would just be the same sort of color. Cool. So we've got that border. And again, sort of just mocking out this content. And I won't get into even fleshing out this content, right? Because it's the same as we've seen before. Using the tailwind flex primitives to put things beside each other and then space them out in the ways that we care about. Cool, so that's that content on the top, and then this bottom section. Let's see what this looks like. So we're going to want to have that be a call as well, and then we can super easily set space. This way, probably 2 or something, 4, who knows. But what we're going to have in here is a bunch of cards, right? So let's keep our, we shall not need 100, but we'll repeat a couple of these just to mock out to show what that looks like. Each, let's give ourselves 10. We don't care which one of these we're on. So let's do that. No, don't care about the contents of it yet, so going to want it to be white. It has a border and it's going to be rounded. Cool. So that's sort of how quickly you can mock out a little card. Let's give it some content. And let's see what that looks like. Cool. So that's those are some cards. They're not tall enough. Let's make those pretend to be some certain height. 64. And we don't want the flex parent to be actually able to change that 64 for us. Cool. So we've got some cards here. Padding's off. So on this, So on this container, we can put the padding. We can't put it on the full like right container because like we've got a border here that we want to be the full width. So, you know, that sort of stuff. Let's put some padding on this container as well, this card, just so that we have some content there. Cool. So those are cards on the right. That's cool. We've got our scrolling container. We're super, super close to the like 40,000 foot view of what that layout is supposed to look like. So that's great. Is there anything super interesting in these cards in terms of layout? I don't think so, right? So it's all stuff that we've seen before. You've got truncation, you've got stuff beside each other. One thing to touch on is that normally when you're truncating things, it's useful to have like tooltips to show people what the truncated content is actually going to look like. We won't get into that detail. That's not necessarily tailwind layout flex applicable. So let's not dive into that. So let's just say.
Just before we move off this, is there an easy way to make the card content, that text, centered both vertically and horizontally?
Yeah, absolutely. Great question. So cool. So one thing you'll notice, so the answer to this is that yes, we can use these flex justification and alignment utilities that we've used to like space between and center things before. If we set those both to center, that'll put it perfectly in the center for us. So let's do that. And just again to exemplify the fact that these things only do stuff for us whenever we're let's see, justify. That these only do things for us whenever we are a flex container. We'll show you what that looks like. Justify content and item center. Right, so we've applied those classes, but that's done nothing for us, right? Because these justify center and item center, these only apply to flex parents, right? So this, again, so setting flex none here has not changed our like rendering system. We're still like a block level element. Our content will just flow normally. But as soon as we make this a flex container, if I could stop navigating away from the file, this then becomes flex and it centers us. So just to show the justification, we can chuck these both down to the end as well, super simply, and then that'll chuck it down into the bottom right hand corner for us. So again, you can play about with any of these properties, but yeah, at a super simple level, card content, we can chuck that in the center by just using justify and align items. So cool. That's it. So that's like most of the inbox there, right? Like ignoring all of these little lovely little red things that we haven't fleshed out because they aren't super interesting to dive into just yet. It's just the actual part, the most functional part of the inbox, which is the conversation stream, like the way that you can interact with the messages and respond to people, that we can lay out next. So that's cool. So we can focus our attention to just one part of the page. So it's sort of this mental exercise of abstracting away a lot of the detail. Like all of this content doesn't apply to any of the layout here. So I can sort of at different zoom levels block these boxes on the page out, such that I'm thinking about just this layout, which is nice, right? So what do we have here? We've got some scrolling container, which it's actually only this content here. So if I can show you there, it's actually only this this container here, and we've got some fixed content at the bottom, this little text area, the composer area, and this sort of, again, sort of a static or a fixed header at the top. It's not fixed, it's not like floating or anything, it's actually just like, this is the scroll container, so it's just another flex container. So we can mock this up again. Let's do that. So again, we can, before we put any content in there, we can tell that this is going to be a flex call, right? So we know that we're going down in the direction, and let's give ourselves some content, some arbitrary height, because we know that that's fixed. We already know that we're not going to want our scrolling container to be able to steal any pixels away from this, and let's go again to our venerable friend red background. And let's do some fixed content at the bottom as well. Cannot type. Excellent. Cool. And this doesn't have a height. This is actually just going to flex to auto. And we already know that it's going to want to be able to overflow. So we can set that right out the bat, right? Before we get any content in here. And we actually do need to have some content, otherwise these will just not be a good example for us. So let's pull that up. What have I changed? Do I have a typo somewhere? Oh, I'm editing my sidebar over here. Cool. What did I change up here? Cool. So let's back some of those changes out. Let's pull this up and pretend that this is actually the boil that we care about. W305. What else did we set? Yeah, we're going to want to take all of these. Forgive me, I was editing the wrong div there, would you believe? That can happen. Oops. And now all of this stuff that no longer applies to this content. What did I have in here? I just had nothing. I had, like, let's say hi, whatever content I had in there. H, flex none. Cool. So I can just get rid of that, right? Cool. I think we're back to where we want to be. Close enough. Let's see. H64, green for flow auto, B. All right, we're getting there. Now, why is my content not being shown here? All right, so we've got A, we're missing B. Where has it gone away to? Flex auto over flow Y auto. What have I done? H64, yeah, cool. So these boils that I had from border B, border get, cool, yeah, cool. So these things that we don't care about, those can go away. So I was still inheriting some of the styles that we had mocked out for this little container here. So that was restricting the size that we were able to expand to. Cool. So again, similar sort of layout, right? So we've mocked some of this content out. Our little section here, C is actually slightly too big. So sometimes it's actually helpful to just, you know, give these colors and see just super visually, like, is that roughly the right size? And then you can start to see. So A here, let's pull that out, this green A section. Let's quickly, so again, before you put any content in there, you know, it's going to be a flex row. Justify between. item center. So this is going to be a super common, right? Like if you want things to be spaced between each other and on along the same line, this is going to be a super set of utilities, which is cool. So and now we're going to have two sections of stuff. So we'll have one over on the left and one over on the right. So this is like title section. Let's put some dummy content in there for now. And there's going to be a bunch of buttons. Let's just make these buttons. Let's make these some stars for now. Nope, not more divs. Stars, please. Thank you. Cool. So now those are little icons, which we'll use as placeholders for buttons just now. If we wanted to, we could come back to that a little bit later and flesh those out to be actually buttons with hover states and active states and all that stuff if we've got time. So let's see. Flex call. So I'm making this a column because what I'm looking at here is just this stacking of like the name on top of the little this other input. So let's see. These probably have some space between them as well. Maybe only one or whatever. And this, does this get to be a heading as well? Who knows? Let's make that a H3. Let's make that a name. Semantically not super important. So let's actually not make an opinionated semantic decision on that now. Let's just say that that's strong. We'll obviously do an accessibility pass if this were to ever hit production. Cool. So we've got Nicola. Let's give it a full name. Tesla. And what is this content below it? Let's just say this is some text, right? We don't necessarily care. Don't necessarily care about what exactly is in here. But we know that it's like small muted text. So text small, text gray, 200 or whatever. And this is some muted text. Cool. So those are stacked on top of each other. If we go back to our page and see.
That's an input. Might it be worth putting an input there so you can show like placeholder colors and things like that?
Oh, yeah. Good idea. Yeah, let's do that. Can we do type text? Well, let us do that. Are those self-closing? I always forget. Let's find out. And then we can get rid of this red because that's no longer helping us whenever we've got light content. Of course, it's way too light.
It needs a value, right?
Of course. Let's see. Can we just placeholder it? Cool. Let's make that a little bit darker. Why not? Cool. I actually haven't used these placeholder. Let me see. Ooh, placeholder. Look at this. Wowee. That's excellent. Placeholder gray 300. Oh, cool. Brilliant. Cool, yeah. So there's a bunch of utilities here that I actually haven't had the chance to use yet, but that's brilliant. So and then when the actual content is there, can we set this to be say like just regular text black? Cool. But of course that is actually a value, not a placeholder. So oops, placeholder ABC, and then as soon as I interact with it and give it a value, black. Cool. Yeah, wow, good old Tailwind, well done. Cool, so that's great. So we've got that roughly sort of mocked out. Let's give this a bit of padding, give ourselves a bit of room.
Now I notice that maybe it's also, maybe not during this pass, but we might come back to it. Like it's got a dashed bottom border and things like that.
Oh, yeah. Let's do that.
Things like focus states and things like that.
Okay, cool. Yeah, let's spend a minute or two just fleshing that out. So border, is it dashed? Yeah. And border B. Again, so these utilities are sort of split up in a neat sort of way where it allows you to set different properties on the border. So like the style and the size and the color and stuff. So border like style. So these are all separated out into like solid dashed, whatever. So you can sort of compose these to get to the thing that you care about. So like dashed, for example, that I think we've set. Did I? Yeah, cool. So dashed, and then we set it to bottom. What else did we set? Cool. So that's already looking, you know, somewhat close. Let's see. How are we getting on? Okay, so it's only on hover that we set the dash. So yeah, fancy stuff. So let's do that.
Hover and focus, I believe.
hover on focus makes sense. And those get combined together, which is cool. Oh, interesting. It's not doing that for me. Border B, border dashed.
Is it because of the outline is covering it?
Possibly. Do we have an outline on this? We don't. Cool, yeah. So, again, Tailwind, quite handily, has some nice utilities about just setting the outline. For example, by just saying outline none. So let's do that. So we don't want that. User agent style sheet default outline. Let's get rid of that. Okay, cool. It's not setting it for us. I am slightly perplexed. Is there a chance that the default config doesn't come with hover for border? No. It must because our yeah, this we were allowed to use it here.
It's probably let's not get bogged down in it. It might be configuration. It might be we're doing something wrong. But
Cool. But trust that this is achievable using the Tailwind utilities. Yeah. It's just we're not gonna spend 10 minutes spelunking to find out what exactly it is. So let's remove that because we don't actually let's not have code here that's not doing anything for us just yet. Let's just say it's always dashed. Cool. Border B. Let's just say it is always dashed, and that outline none is actually still good. And text placeholder, cool. So we're still super close here. We just haven't got the perfect interaction hover state. But that's not what we need at this first pass. Cool, and we put one star over here. Let's put a couple of those.
Perhaps while you're at it, you could change the placeholder to whatever the intercom one is. Visually
good idea.
Looks good.
Add conversation title. That sounds more useful than ABCD. Cool. And now let's make this, just put these beside each other. And item center. We don't care about justification here because it's just some content beside each other. So let's have four of those. That seems like a lovely number. We actually have five here, but yeah, we'll not get bogged down on that. And probably some space between. Do we want to actually spend a minute here and turn these into sort of hoverable buttons, or do we want to flesh out this this main content first?
I guess we've about half an hour left, so
okay.
If you think we've time.
Yeah, let's flesh out the main content, and then we can make a call on what's the most interesting stuff for us to look at after. Because you'd mentioned the little relatively positioned status indicator over there as well too, which might be interesting to look. This is a little bit more sort of a nuanced UI polish than this sort of layout problem that we've been trying to solve here so far. Cool. So let's shift focus down to the rest of this sort of main inbox like conversation stream here. And let's see what else we have. So we've got green. Let's just leave that as green for now because we can get to that in a second. And let's flesh out this. So this doesn't need to be blue, but it can have a little bit of padding, right? And then we'll put our little input in beside it. So let's make this a 4 or 5 or something. Who knows? And then this. It's not going to be perfect, but let's just mark this out as a text area for now. And let's see what's going on. Cool. So we've got a lovely text area here. That's great. Not exactly as fully functioned, fully featured as the inbox composer, but we're getting close. Let's see. Let's make this full width. And we can actually just make it full height as well. Because it'll be bounded by the size of the parent, and we've already given it a fixed height. So again, these are just height utilities. Let me show you here. I wish it would clear that after I've found a search, but that's okay. So there's different like these unit values, and we've also got like auto 1 pixel full screen. So we've seen us use screen at the very top level, like application wrapper sort of div, and full is just a super handy utility for height 100%. This is one of the things that before Tailwind, like this lives in so many classes around our app, so it's nice to be able to just say very very explicitly this thing is getting height 100 in the template. It's super super readable, so we can height full to be full. What does it look like here? So we don't actually want the outline. So again, we can use that outline none utility. Oops. On this high, cool. But we do want a bit of a border. And again, we can make that. Oh, no, blue with some number, probably 400. That blue on hover. Cool. So we're getting close. Make that a little bit darker. And let's round that. Cool. Let's give it a little bit of padding as well. Again, I'm just picking four here because it's a nice round number. It's easy to type. We can come back to that and tweak that after. But let's see. Cool. So we're getting close here, right, of the hover. And let's see. Let's set that to focus as well. So again, super handy. We can just set this pseudo selector prefix. Focus. Cool. So now you'll notice whenever I'm typing in here and I move my mouse up over to here, it's still same focus. So again, you can achieve all these nice interaction patterns just using simple utilities. Is there anything else we need to flesh out there?
Shadow. You'll trust me. Shadow, that we... perhaps.
Go ahead. Oh, yeah. Shadow. Yeah. Shadow. Let's do that. LG, probably. Large shadow. Close enough. That's looking good. Look at that. Cool. So we'll park that there for now. You'll trust me that we know how to lay out content inside this. There's nothing groundbreaking about what's going on inside here. That's cool. And now we can, refocus on this main sort of scrolling container of where the actual messages are coming in. So one thing that I believe we can just steal directly from production here is this lovely little background. So let's steal this lovely little set of squiggles. Hello, you. Would you believe Tailwind doesn't have a utility for applying Intercom's conversation background image? So we're gonna have to inline this one for now. Of course, this could live in custom CSS. It's one of these things where for super custom things like this, you could configure it in your Tailwind config if you had a set of backgrounds. But it's not the worst thing in the world to have a CSS file with a couple of very domain specific settings like this. So say if I go back up to here, I make this not blue, but actually. Sorry, not green, but actually have a, forgive me, an inline style tag of background image is this big long messenger thing. Let's split that out just to show you what I'm talking about here. It's not the worst thing in the world to have some domain specific stuff alongside your utility classes. So we can do that here. My linter is going to keep screaming at me for no inline styles. That's fine. We can live with that shame and we can move on. So we still actually got green here. Wow, look at that. Maybe we should submit that for design credit. So we've get rid of green here and we've got this lovely squiggle background. That is absolutely wonderful. Love it. So we can, let's actually get rid of this padding top. So you notice here before I save the file, there's a bit of a gap between our lovely little composer here and this background, which is a little bit jarring. So let's just get rid of that by overriding this like generic apply to all sides, all faces padding. That you can override that with a little bit more specific of a padding top 0, just be gone padding top, which is cool. So now we've got this lovely little background, which is really neat, and we can now put some content on top of that. So let's do that. Let's flesh that out. Let's get rid of this so that I can see. Cool. So we can speed through this. Let's speed run this, and we can get some actual conversations in here. So div class. Let's make a conversation. What's that probably looking at? Again, we can look at this. Let's take it one of these items. It's like, again, this direction. I suppose the first thing to do when looking at these, just figure out which direction it's going in. This is going in row. So we can set that. Flex row, which is cool. And there's probably some gaps between those. Let's say, who knows, 2. Excellent. And then there will be some more content inside these. So if we look at these, each one of these rows here, one of those will be one of the lines, one of the entries in our inbox, like conversation stream, if you want to call it that here. So let's do that. Let's again pull up user rounded. Okay, it doesn't actually give those metadata, so I'm going to have to go back here and steal this lovely user circle. Let's pull that in because we know we're going to need one of those, a lovely picture. Let's. This is going to be like the actual message itself. If I go back here, oh, it's actually blue, of course. Yeah, cool. That makes sense. Blue 200, it gets a message, it's rounded, it has some padding, And again, we can super quickly mock this out. So this is like some message text. And again, this is one of these things. It doesn't have to be super high fidelity. It doesn't have to be like actual dynamic content yet. Feel free to mock these things out with just sentences. Totally fine. Cool. Let's actually flip this around so that the text comes first. Actually, I think it's easier if we conceptually think about this as coming from left to right to start with. So if we look at mocking up one of these messages, let's do that instead. So what we're making is one of these. Let's do that. Cool, cool, cool. Some message text. That could be gray again. And it's actually close enough to what we want here. Let's put some padding on this lovely little squiggle background thing. Put some padding here. Cool, so now these messages are off from the very side, which is nice. And one other thing I notice is that this top level thing that we didn't fully flesh out, let's just give it a border bottom just so that it marks that. Right, just so that there's a line here, a break between the top and the bottom, so we can easily see. Padding doesn't feel like enough. Right, you know, just beneath this. Cool. So let's make you a little bit taller too. Cool. Great. So now we can flesh this out a little bit more. How close are we here? Yeah, we've got some hover state icons. Those aren't super difficult to implement, so we won't get bogged down on that yet. Cool, this timestamp, we can put that beneath it as well. Let's do that. So that's beneath the actual message content. So we can do that by just having this be a div. And we'll let that flex to auto if it wants to. But this is the message content, and then again, make this a flex. Container, some call, and then we can have this be another div. I forget what the content's actually supposed to be. 3 months. Okay, yeah, cool. So 5 hours ago was close enough of a message content. Cool, and we can make that slightly lighter and slightly smaller. Cool, so that's looking good. Actually, we don't want this to flex to auto because by setting flex auto on this container, it's going to actually allow this gray background to fill up the full space. And we don't need that. It's sort of visually heavy if you only have this much content. So let's fix that. Let's go back and pick a better flex property than auto. And one that we can use here is, what do we actually care about? It can shrink, can't auto. I think the easiest thing is for it to just not, for it to not grow by default at all. So we can just not set auto on it. So we can just have it be the default, which is cool. And that can still be a flex call. Cool. So that sort of does what we want to. And let's test with some arbitrarily long message. See that it wraps around. It does. Cool. Oh yeah, another example of our icons getting destroyed by being too small. Let's fix that. Again, just one thing to be careful of, setting these flex none. We'll see that apportion space properly. Cool, excellent. So now we can get rid of this boyo. It's a big long text. Cool, so we're sort of close there, right? Like we're getting close to messages. Let's just put a couple of these in the page. Let's see. Let's make a few, let's just to automate the scrolling, let's make a handful of these. Cool. And sort of conceptually, you can see anywhere where like we're sitting down here and like to avoid repetition, to avoid like copy pasting a bunch of template, anywhere where we do that or anywhere where we're like repeating, you could see this being broken out into its own component because those sort of like natural boundaries of where like, you know, me copy pasting this just because I want a second message sort of implies that it should have its own sort of wrapper around that, some sort of abstraction, at least at just the layout level. In Ember, it's super cheap to just abstract that away into its own template only component. There's no JavaScript backing that. It's just a template abstraction, so we can pass in properties and change content if we need to. But let's do that. So let's see. Let's put 10 of them. beside each other. Probably going to want a gap between some of these. Space Y2 or something. Probably 4 would be a bit more, afford a bit more content. Perfect. Yeah, let's just put 4 between it. It doesn't need to be perfect. There's actually some dynamic spacing between these. You see here where we sort of collapse these two beside each other because they're from the same sender directly. But you know, whenever you have these alternating things or whenever you've got statuses, those fit through as well. So let's see. One thing we can do is sort of alternate the who is actually sending it. So this is like the admin sending the message, and this is the end user, so someone interacting with the messenger. So let's actually flip that around, and let's make a state for that. I think we've looked at this. I think it's actually possible to just flip the direction. So one thing that Flex has a concept of that we've touched on is the direction. And we could just set reverse on this. That should work, right? So we can, so we're not changing it to call such that we'll be stacked on top of each other, but we can set Flex for reverse. And what that will do is it'll mess with the order of the children inside that container. So there's ways you can like explicitly say, you know, you go here, you go here, you go here, regardless of where exactly, like say, for example, here, if I put this as 1 and this is 2, right? So in normal layout flow, there's no real way to like, aside from like floating things around to like have this, the div that's defined second in our template come before number 1 here in our layout flow, but Flex will allow us to do that quite easily. So we can mess with the order here. So let's see. We actually do care about this index. And Dave might look a little bit confusing here. It's a little Ember helper for division. Is it mod? Do we care about mod?
Mm-hmm.
I forget exactly which one we care about here, but it's let's just say mod 2. So every second one is going to be an admin message. So let's see.
Yeah. So every second one will be 0, and 0 is falsely in Ember. So sometimes it'll be true, sometimes it'll be false.
Sweet. Yeah, so div wasn't right there. So mod's cool. So let's see. Cool. Right, so now we've alternated those. So every second message is from the admin. Let's give ourselves a few more here to scroll. Cool, and that's nice, right? Because then we can actually do is... this would probably be, if this were a component, this would be passed in as a single property, so we wouldn't have to keep redefining this conditional, but
You could use let to just let, you know, from...
Oh, admin, yeah, yeah, right? Good shout. That does indeed make sense. So let's do that. You can just do that. Yeah.
Let mod i2 as from admin.
Nice. From admin. Cool. And now we have that. So we don't need to keep repeating that conditional because we're going to have to use it in a couple of places here. So then if from admin, not amen. If from admin, we can set that. And let's close our let block here. Cool. And now let's check this. How are we getting on? My indentation's a little bit off here. There we go, fixed. So let's make sure that still works. Cool. Yeah, those are alternating. And now we can use that conditional again to be a little bit fancy about how we set this. So if from admin, amen. So if it's from admin, we want this to actually be blue. Right, so you can use these utilities with some like dynamic state to change the UI based on some application conditions. So that's handy, right? So as soon as we play that, hopefully, yeah, cool. So that makes that blue 200. That's way too heavy. You see here, maybe we made that 100 too. I'm not a designer here, so you'll have to trust me that this is close enough to what we're looking for. Cool. So now we've got these sort of the direction happening. You sort of see, like, depending on the sender, they're sort of mirrored. So we can just do something as simple as reversing the direction. One thing that I think we actually need to fix is that this gap is wrong. I think the space utilities have a special way of space between. They have a special way of understanding this. Yeah, cool. Special way of understanding this change in direction. So let's let's apply that to this place where we are setting the reverse, SpaceX reverse. Cool, and now that gap has come back, right? Cool. So yeah, so there we are. We're super, super close there.
Perhaps the colors are, the gray is a little bit light. That's
it is.
Quite close.
Cool.
To
let's
the
go
way.
Back to 200. Yeah, we're getting close. Look at that.
Nice.
Cool. So is there anything interesting? Yeah, and just as a simple example here, didn't want to click that. As a simple example here, we can just show what, let's see. If I, so say, if this is the 10th message, we can put some like status message in here or something. So let's do that. So let's, just to show you what this sort of centered content looks like, and we can do that really easily. So, flex row, justify center, right? So it's as simple as that, and then you would have any sort of dynamic content in here. Let's see what we have. You assign this conversation to yourself. Cool. So apparently for the 10th thing, I did that. So let's do that and see what that looks like. Cool. So that's centered now, and of course we could make that small and slightly gray. Something like that. Cool. Right, so we're getting super close here. The contrast isn't perfect on that, but you'll trust me that those are close enough, and we'll obviously fix those up as we go along. So yeah, so that's sort of like, you know, if you take a step back, 40-foot view, ignoring the red bits that we've skipped for time's sake, there's not super interesting content in there. Like, we're pretty close, right? Like, that's close enough to an intercom inbox to me. So is there anything in particular you think we could take a look at?
No, this is great. I mean, the last thing I'd be interested in seeing is just the icon on the left menu that just is positioned in a different way.
Yeah,
the little red five, right?
Yeah, yeah. I think that's a good example of like something that's a little bit more finicky, a little bit requires a little bit more finesse than just laying out boxes on the page. So let's do that. That's cool. Let's pick an icon. Look at that, hero icons. Well done. They've got an icon for this. Let's go back up to our scaffold of content at the top here. Which one was it? The second. So we go back to our scaffold of content here. And instead of it being around a div inside there, let's fill in our icon. So let's do that. And what did we want to do? Cool. So this A tag. So let's just pop that in and make sure that still looks correct. Slightly too small. Cool. Looks excellent. That's an inbox logo. Cool. So one thing to think about when doing this is that so we know what content we want to go in there. So we want it to be a circle with a red background and a five inside it. So let's just do that. We can do that and leave it in the normal layout flow. So let's do that. 500 or something. We'll give it some fixed width to, who knows. It should probably be based on the line height of our font that's going to go in there. But let's just do that. We can make the text white because we're going to be on a red background. And is there anything else we need to do there around it? I believe that is it. And then we're going to have the special magic number 5. Again, that indicates how many unread conversations or open conversations I have. Cool, so we're getting close there. That's not big enough. Text, probably XS would be nice. And we probably still want that to be something like 12 pixels. So let's see what this looks like. Still too small. Oh, and yes, we want it rounded full. So Tailwind has a nice utility for building circles, which is basically just setting rounded to full. So it sets it to 50% or whatever it is. Many pixels. But you can do that to basically turn a div into a circle if you've got a full background. So that's cool. Yeah, circle. Great. I've got an example for that. Cool. So what do we look like now? Close enough. We're slightly still too small. We'll get there eventually. And to center this, you'll notice that our five is slightly off. We could probably just text align. Text center. How are we getting on there? That's close. And again, to just show you what that looks like. Align text. Oops. You can go left, left, center, right, justify. Again, of course, if you can think that there should be utility of some of these things, there normally is. So that's cool. So what have we done to the page now? We've put a 5 beneath the inbox logo. Close enough, like, you know, at a pass, if that was all you could do, that you could ship that, that's fine. But let's position it over the top right-hand corner. And a way we can do that, so to get out of the normal layout flow of the page, we can make this absolutely positioned. So we can make this absolutely positioned. And what that's going to do is take it out of the normal layout flow of the app. It's taking it out such that it's not taking up any more space. So here, if I zoom in to show you what this looks like, you'll notice that beneath this icon, so beneath the inbox icon, the second like placeholder icon comes straight in. There's no gap between there. And this, you could think of this as just like floating, hovering on top of the rest of the content. So that allows us to then position that wherever we want. So Tailwind has some nice utilities around that. So they've got some layout utilities for that. If we look at the docs about, you know, placing some absolutely positioned content somewhere. So we can set top 0, right 0. Let's do that on this container. And I suppose we can already tell what's going to happen here. It's going to disappear in front of our very eyes, because what we've done is told it to go to the top and to the right of something. We haven't told it exactly what yet, so it's going to go to the viewport. It's actually going to go to the closest stacking context, or, you know, the next relatively positioned element. So let's actually tell it where we want it to be constrained in. So this, like, A tag, let's say that this is our relative container. We can make that now live exactly within this container. So we're getting a little bit maybe lucky here that this A is actually the wrong size. You know, for accessibility purpose and for just ease of use, you would want this A to actually be the full size of the container. So let's actually make that so. With full, I believe in the app, we actually just give these like specific heights and widths. So like this would be, we give these, is it the full width of the thing? Right, because you want this A tag, this full thing, to be clickable. Whatever the law is of, you know, moving your mouse to the full edge of the page and still being able to click on an A tag, that still applies here. So let's do that. W full, that's not helping us here. Let's make you a block. Let's see how you're getting on. Oh, it's still not. Oh, because there's padding on that. Okay, yeah, cool. So yeah, we don't need to get into that. Let's drop that for a second. Padding 4. Right, because we want this to be the full width. So let's see. The rest of these should be good now. How are we getting on? Oh, and this would want to be with full. Oh, so again, that's another thing too. Instead of flipping between your template and the browser, a bunch of browsers have cool dev tools that allow you to interactively apply classes that are in scope, so classes that are on the global style sheet. So we can just set here, like we can set W full on this to test out and see what that would look like. If I had just to set that to W2 or 4, like you can see this interactively. So it's a nice sort of interactive sort of debugging experience. People have set that. Cool. So that now that we've tested that works in the app, we can set this to W full. What we could actually do is just set this to be like flex auto, but we don't necessarily need to. So let's just say you're the full width. And again, I'm just going through the layout here to show us that if we need to position this thing in a more sort of special way, we can. Cool. Now this can be and now just this A tag. Yep.
Justify center is misspelled.
Thank you. Justify center. So Are we getting on here now? Cool. Right. So what we've done there is basically the same trick that we used to put the content centered inside the card. We've done that to inside this A tag, which is the link, right? So these are actually links to other parts of the app away from the inbox, but this is the thing to the inbox. We want this A to be as big as possible, right, in that container so that we can click on it. What we've done by making this like justify center item center is just like centered that SVG bang in the middle, which is perfect. But this sort of gives us a better sort of example of like when you're inside this relative container, sometimes you don't get to decide exactly, you know, my relative container is the SVG or whatever. If it's still a bit bigger, you can use Tailwind to like reposition this absolutely positioned element in. So yeah, if you wanted to, you could. Do we have specific top values? You could configure this with top, like you could say top, you know, top four, top five, whatever. We can also just like nudge this in the right direction with margins. So if we wanted to, we can, so this floating container, you could say margin right 3 or whatever. Let's see what that gives us. So we can nudge this sort of into the right position. Cool. So that's brought it roughly in line, and we can give that a margin top as well, which might bring it close enough to what we care about here. And again, it doesn't need to be exactly pixel perfect. We could of course configure that as much as we need to in our config if we couldn't achieve it with the default stuff out of the box. But that's sort of an example of us getting super close to where we need to with this. Let's make this, let's align our lovely little placeholder icons here by giving this a div. There we go, cool. And we can give this a nice PT5 or whatever, and this can get a PB5. What I'm doing here is I had moved this like entire wrapping container around that primary nav that had the padding on it all to just be at the top of the bottom, because we want the A tags to be the full width of this container, just because it's good. It's good. It's good accessibility and usability. So cool. That's great. So yeah, so that's sort of an example of being able to. Of being able to do more sort of discrete UI patterns, small little interactions like that. You can still achieve those using Tailwind totally just fine. So yeah, that's that.
Nice. This is great. Thanks very much. I learned absolutely loads. I'm continue to be amazed with what's possible with Tailwind and how quick it is and how much fun it is. So thanks for bringing us through it.
Cool, cool. Cheers.
See you later.
See ya.
Bye.